Okay, afternoon, everybody. I'm the aggregates guy at RAP, and I was going to say seem. I have been talking to gatherings of this sort now for more years than I care to think about, under David. And I have faith that eventually things will happen. Okay, what I'm covering, we're talking about recycled concrete aggregate, but I'm looking at recycled aggregates in a broader context. So the construction aggregates market, recycled aggregates in both unbound and bound applications, i.e. concrete, asphalt and drainage, subbase, so on and so forth. And then moving on to RAP and resource efficiency in construction, the broader range of stuff which we've got web-based and in other forms within RAP that can help you in terms of construction. So aggregates. I can bore for England on aggregates. The construction aggregate market is split up into various formats. Okay, so stuff that's going into concrete and concreting sands are that sort of 35% bit. Asphalt, down there about 11%. Fills, subbase, cappings, drainage materials, this bit down here. Now, crushed rock, which is one of the most similar things to crushed concrete in terms of the characteristics of the material, therefore, recycled concrete tends to be replacing crushed rock in marketplaces. Most of this lot, i.e. 50% of all aggregates and about 65-70% of all crushed rock aggregates go into those sectors. They go into the ground, they go into civils, whereas higher strength aggregates are going into ready mix and precast concrete and into asphalt and sands go in between. So although we're talking about putting materials into concrete, it's a relatively small sector of the market relative to the total market. And high strengths of natural sands and gravels predominantly are the main materials that are going into ready mix and precast concrete. If you're running a quartzitic sand and gravel plant on the Trent Valley, 85% of your business will be going to fix that. That's ready mix and precast concrete plants. Whereas crushed rock operations, more of it will be going to, a proportion will be into asphalt, but the rest will be going in to a broader range civil engineering materials. So it's using the right material for the right application in the right place, because you don't want to be hauling stuff all over the place. Most aggregates, natural aggregates, are only hauled, the average haulage distance for natural aggregates is about 25 miles. So it tends to be local markets. There are exceptions, but it puts it in context. Right. How is that demand for aggregates met? It's met from crushed rock, natural sand and gravel, marine sand and gravel, which has chlorides, and recycled and secondary aggregates. We have 28% of demand being met from recycled and secondary aggregates. It is the status quo. It's the standard play within UK. You use all resources that are available for aggregates. Mineral planning for England stipulates, in terms of planning consent for natural materials, that demand for aggregates will first be met from aggregates from alternative resources, from crushed rock, sorry, from recycled aggregates and secondary aggregates. So there is a presumption that these materials will be used. How's that changed over time? Top line crushed rock, middle line sand and gravel, bottom line recycled and secondaries. Recycled is concrete, brick, asphalt, stone, ceramics, materials previously used in construction. They make up of that 28%, about 22% is recycled and secondary, and 6% is secondary materials, which includes things like aggregates from steel slag, from blast furnace slag, and furnace bottom ash from coal-fired power stations, a proportion of PFA, but byproducts from other industrial processes. Now then, you'll see that recycled and secondary have actually overtaken sand and gravel. And this dip here is 2007 when the bottom dropped out of the market and we really hit recession and the construction industry felt it big time. Construction aggregate demand dropped about 30%. The market share of recycled and secondary materials nudged up a bit. It was running about 26, 27, it moved up to 28. So when things are tight and people are looking at margins, they're looking to use alternative materials. So, but the tonnages have actually dropped a touch. In terms of the potential for recycled, secondary, specifically recycled, we can't go a lot further than that. If you look at landfill data, the construction sector, in terms of construction, demolition and excavation waste, generates in England about 92, 93 million tonnes a year. The stuff that is discarded into landfill, that is paying landfill tax, is about 9 million tonnes. When you take the soils out of that, clays and subsoils out of it, there's 5 million tonnes. The rest is recovered, reused, recycled. So people don't throw construction and demolition materials away. The big flow that goes in is predominantly excavation waste, which is subsoils and clays. And I checked last night, sort of thing I do at night, just to see what amount of concrete, which is a waste code 170101, actually goes straight into landfill. Bear in mind, the stuff that goes in isn't discarded into landfill, it goes in for engineering purposes, because it has a value. So landfill operators have got to attract that material in, and there was about 75,000 tonnes going into England landfill, 75,000 tonnes out of total going into landfill, well, discarded into landfill, of 10 million. It was a cupful, and it was going into engineering. They can't get it because it's recycled. I got the point. aggregates. Aggregates are covered by product standards. Three product standards, one for unbound applications, including hydraulically bound mixtures, one for asphalt, bituminous mixers, and one for concrete. These are mandated, harmonised standards, product standards, under the Construction Products Directive, now Construction Products Regulations. It shows how these materials have got to be made so that they can be CE marked. From July 2013, Construction Products Regulations means that a whole rake of construction products must be CE marked, including aggregates, which is the way they are made. They have to be produced to factory production control systems and tested in accordance with the parameters within the standards. They are product standards. You produce something to a standard, you know what size it is, what its strength is, what its other characteristics are. Once you know that, and somebody comes to you with a specification that says, I want something that's capable of doing this, this, and this, you can match your product standard data to the specifications requirements, and therefore you can meet what the customer requires. Hence, David, when you're producing stuff from concrete at Sellafield, if you produce it to a standard, you can demonstrate it will meet a specification, which is what the asphalt producer needs. Right. So, lots of stuff on these. Right. Talking about concrete, aggregates for concrete, BS EN12620. And I say, aggregates can be made from natural recycled and manufactured. Manufactured covers things like slags, materials. Standards are resource blind. It's the ability of the material to be produced and fit for purpose that matters, as long as it doesn't create environmental risk or kill anybody. The aggregates concrete guys are a complex world of the world of concrete. The standard for producing aggregates for concrete is 12620. That feeds into a European standard, 206, which is specifications for concrete and materials. And in UK, we then have BS 8500-2, which is a complementary standard to 206. Our concrete guys in England don't like the European stuff, they do their own stuff. And because that is not a harmonised standard, individual member states can do their own things. Harmonised standards, which are that top one and the other two, they are mandatory on all member states. You can't have your own, you have to produce to these standards. Concrete standard has certain limitations within it as to how you can use recycled aggregates and recycled concrete aggregates. And as RAP and the industry, we did this big report looking at the limitations within the concrete standards and saying, could you really push things further than that? Because The concrete standard says for the, and again, this is what David mentioned, for stuff in the ground, you can use up to 100% recycled aggregates, recycled concrete aggregates, subject to one or two things. But once you're going up to very high strength concrete, then there's a limitation of 20% replacement with coarse aggregates, which is the 4 mil to the 20 mil. We push the boundaries on that to see what really happens. You can go more. It makes perfectly good concrete, but the characteristic of crushed concrete results in it having a higher water demand. If you have a higher water demand to maintain strength, you've got to put in more cement. If you put in more cement, it's more expensive. It also significantly increases carbon. Ton of aggregate, to make a ton of aggregate, generates 5 kilograms of carbon per ton of aggregate produced. To produce a ton of cement, it's about 950 kilograms of carbon per ton of cement. So you don't want to be shoving too much cement in if you're going to be controlling carbon. So there's a lot you can do, but it doesn't necessarily mean you have to do. It's using the right material, the right application, the right place. Right. Which is why most crushed concrete and most recycled aggregates tend to go into unbound applications and others, but in civil engineering. Stuff that's going into the ground, underneath slabs, pavements, underneath big industrial sheds, underneath places like this, you would be using unbound recycled aggregates. The Department of Transport and the Highways Agency have this website where you can get all the various bits and pieces if you're really stuck for something to read. Series 500 is for aggregates, among other things, for drainage and pipe bedding. 600 is for earthworks, which is fills and cappings. 800 is for sub-base and hydraulically bound mixtures. And 900 is for asphalt, and 1,000 is for pavement concrete. And that's the thing going across the top. These are all the sort of secondary and recycled materials. Recycled aggregates, recycled concrete, you can use in the lot, subject to them being produced to a quality standard that also enables them to be seen to be end of waste, which is the aggregates quality protocol, which I'm pleased to say has been mentioned several times. Thank you. So I was intrigued on your stuff on Claire. It was really interesting. The quality protocol is a nice thin document. It's been out since 2004. We've had downloaded about 35,000 copies. But it's a quality management system that makes sure the material you're processing is inert, so you don't create more environmental risk in its use than aggregate from natural resources, that it's produced in line with European aggregate standards, and that there is a certainty of market. Those things define end of waste, so the regulators are happy. That shows an aggregate has ceased to be waste and can be used in the broader marketplace as an ordinary product. And the Environment Agency, people purchasing aggregates know that it'll meet their specifications as well, so it's good stuff. As opposed to the CLEB Code of Practice, which will still, if you're crushing aggregates on a site like Bradwell, you will still be wanting them to meet an engineering specification, which is what you were doing. But because you have a defined site, you can look at environmental risk in a different way. So you can set different parameters relative to the potential impact of a material, which enables it to be used, in fact, never to be classified as waste within that site. And so it's a useful tool. Right. What I want to get onto is the broader stuff which we're doing in terms of RAP on construction and how that relates to the way that you can look at using recycled aggregates and other materials in new build and so on. As RAP, we started on aggregates in 2002 and it evolved into a very broad construction program along the broader range of things that we do within RAP. And now we're moving more on to resource efficiency. So rather than looking to reduce material going to landfill, we're looking at stopping waste being produced in the first place, looking at construction methodologies, so that you use stuff better and you lose less stuff. That will relate to aggregates as well. But in fact, our next program now that goes on for the next 3 years in construction will be looking to specifically resource efficiency agreements within the sector. So construction, energy, materials, water. We actually are dealing with water now, not so much on energy, but on terms of materials. All this is really just giving you a feel of the stuff we've got. So you've got materials coming in, as part of new build construction, and out, part of demolition, and materials generated as waste during construction. And so we cover all these elements. So design, procurement, site management. In terms of procurement, we have contract clauses that you can drop into tender documentation so that people will use materials better, will ensure they are not generating waste, that they are more resource efficient. And you can see all the various things. We do all this. You can get lost in our website forever. But the two big things are designing out waste, which is by designing out waste, it could just as easily be badged as resource efficiency in construction. It's looking at the ways that things can be done better. We did this one in conjunction with Reba. And these all link into tools on our website. You want me to read that, so I'll get a bit bigger. You still can't read it. But the five principles of designing out waste are design for reuse and recovery, design for off-site construction, which is one of the real keys to reducing construction waste, design for materials optimization, design for waste efficient procurement, and a point which came up today, design for deconstruction and flexibility. When you're building something at the start, think what you're going to do with it at the end. So we have a whole lot of information on those which link into tools, web-based tools. Because of time, I'm not going to go into the total detail on them. And I think Owen's going to provide some links later on, are you? Yes. As to where these things are. And we have a similar guide for designing out waste in civil engineering. And again, it's not just waste management, it's how you use things, including soils, aggregates, everything else. It's in two bits. There's a design guide and there's a technical solution. So that tells you all the stuff you can do, and that goes into more detail on how it works. So the design guide is the same. There are various elements in it, but again, I'm picking up this one. So design for reduced recovery, deconstruction, materials optimization, all this sort of information on how you can use materials, including recycled aggregates and recycled concrete aggregate. That's in part one. In part two, there's a whole lot on technical solutions. And this is just a sample I've lifted out of it. So there are various elements within civils. I've just pulled off the section on earthworks, but it goes into things like geosynthetics, into hydraulically bound mixtures, how you can take soils, which from an engineering point of view might not have the strength that you're requiring for construction on site, which you might be taking off. But if those soils are dealt with by stabilisation, hydraulic binders, geotextiles, geogrids, you can change the performance and enable them to stay on site. All those sort of things. And I just put those two on, which is development site infrastructure, flood defence, got to be like coastal protection. There's a whole lot of things in there for you to have a look at and find useful. Within the website, these designing out waste tools, you can put in for individual contracts the various things which you're looking. You can compare options relative to use of materials, waste generated, carbon generated. You can link them into the net waste tool, which is balancing in the amount of recycled materials you're using relative to the amount of waste that you are generating. A lot of sites want to make sure that their net waste is negative, positive. Whereas they are using more recycled materials than they are generating waste. And those goes into site waste management plan templates and things which you can use. So there's a lot of on-site tools and guidance. The website, the construction pages, this is just the construction lot, and there's our halving waste to landfill stuff, which is will be moving into the sustainability resource efficiency agreement. We've got about 750 contractors, suppliers, consultants signed up to our halving waste to landfill, which includes the majority by far of the UK contractors group, which is all the big producers. So this is the way things are going. And there's tools and guidance for the things that I was talking about, designing out waste tools. I'm not sure that's the last one I did. How to reduce waste, and information on construction materials with recycled content as well. Lots and lots and lots of stuff. The aggregates, specifically aggregate site, which again, I was pleased has been mentioned. We have, this is just the home page. There's an opportunities section, which you can play around for ages with, which has a diagram with different types of construction. And when you hover over them, it splits them into the various elements. So concrete roads, hydraulically bound materials, earthworks, and there's one at the somewhere down there, concrete structures, which is that one. And when you click on that, you end up with a whole range of concrete structures, and you click on each one. In this case, it's 11, which is power station, which I thought was relatively relevant, and it refers to for concretes as well. So if you're looking for general ideas, this is a good tool to have. We also have, under the quality section, the quality module, which is all about quality management systems, and the aggregates quality protocol, where you can get download the QP and checklists and guidance notes and so on. Lots of stuff to do with standards. And I think that's probably given you an overload on aggregates.